This is the third Sunday after Pentecost. It's also a day when we are remembering our vocation, the gifts and talents that God gives us. And we have a few very brave people who have stepped forward and offered their own gifts and talents for us. And we're so grateful that they are able to share those. In our service, we're trying to be a little bit more like we were before the pandemic. We have been trying to restrict a lot of movement, but now there are more times to stand and sit, but please feel free to remain seated if that's easier for you. Please rise as you are able for the confession and assurance found on page 4. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not always shared our gifts and talents, but have sometimes given our light. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we tend to take the best seats at the table. When met by others in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves, and free us to love our neighbors. Amen.
Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves you. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share that peace with one another, probably by wave, or as a peace symbol. We're still in the pandemic, so a little careful.
Just for you today.
Earth and All Stars. Please remain standing as you are able for this song found on pages 4 and 5.
Thank you.
and also with you.
I was just in Tennessee and a lot of people were there. So Imagine yourself in a room with all of your favorite foods, and you're the only one there. I mean, your favorite cake or your favorite pizza or something favorite. Now, open your eyes. Now, what would you do if you saw all these great things, all these yummy things? And you're hungry. And you have a fork. What would you do? What would you do? You take a little bit of each one, right? Wouldn't you? It'd be fun, right?
Probably.
Yeah, it might be too greedy. So this is what I wanted to tell you about. Sometimes we think about me, like what I'm hungry, these are my favorite foods. And then we hear about the commandments you just read so well. Thank you so much. And it's like God wants us to turn that around and make it about we. All of a sudden, if there's a lot of food, like you already said it, if it's too much and you can't eat it, what would you do? Give to others. Right, like when we were in Tennessee, we took a tour of the place where Alex Haley was born. He wrote this really great book about his ancestry, about his forefathers, and it's called Roots, talking about his people coming from Africa to the United States. It was a great book. And the person who was giving us the tour talked about what life was like when the Haley family was living there. And he said, a lot of times people didn't quite have enough. And he was talking about how refrigerators were invented and you put leftovers in a refrigerator for the first time. And his grandmother said, a leftover? What's a leftover? And I thought, like, oh, they must eat a lot. They were thinking of the meat, right? I must be able to eat all the food. What the grandmother said is, how can we have leftovers when the guy across the street is hungry? How can we have leftovers when our neighbor down the block doesn't have enough food? There are no leftovers. You're supposed to share it. So that was a good reminder about God wants us to think of we. And these are what all of the commandments are that we're talking about is taking care of our neighbor, like not taking their stuff and respecting their property and their reputation. So we're going to just remind ourselves, it's not about us. And it doesn't mean you can't have some. I like your taking a little taste of everything, but you can also, sharing is a big part of what we are supposed to do. So we're going to offer up a prayer. Whatever I say, you say. Ready? Dear God, thank you for what you give us.
Thank you for what you give us.
Help us to remember to share.
Help us to remember to share.
Amen. As simple as that, just sharing. Thank you so much for coming up and helping us understand the we. So last week we did the first part. Oh, I just saw you come. You could have come up too. I'm sorry, Lily. You heard it, right? You prayed. Last week we heard a lot in the lessons about loving God, that we were going to honor God's name, honor the Sabbath. We were only going to have one God, that kind of thing. And just like that, this week we're focusing in on our neighbors. And I like to think that I love my neighbors. But then I got stuck in traffic on the JFX on Wednesday afternoon. There was this accident that closed the left two lanes in the three-lane northbound road, and we were just inching along. It was going so slow. And I thought, okay, I knew there was an accident, and I thought, like, okay, Christian Care, Holy God, watch over the people in that accident. Watch over the responders. Amen. See, I'm a good Christian. I care about other people. And then we inched along a little bit more, and I saw several cars racing down the right lane that was going to disappear in a quarter of a mile. And I know it was going to disappear in a quarter of a mile because the sign said, the lane ends in a quarter of a mile. They knew it was ending, but they were zooming past. The people behind us were now in front of us. And I felt anger. I wish that when they finally got up to our lane, that nobody would let them in. And then I thought, you know, Christian, maybe they're running home to be with their children. Maybe there's an important appointment and they really need to get home. So, okay,
Now it's a little bit of a balance. Some judgment, but some loving Christian care, right? And we inched along a little more. The temporary right lane had ended, but people were still zooming past, this time on the right shoulder. That was really not fair. I was really unhappy with these drivers, and I did a little mental superiority dance from my driver's seat, and I said, well, I'm following the rules, and I'm being patient, and they're all going to get tickets someday. When the pickup truck behind me was clearly also irritated and straddled their lane and the shoulder, I was like, you go. Yeah, don't let her pass. I was happy. That seemed like justice. So even at this point, I have to say, maybe a little more judgmental, a little less love. That experience was frustrating for me. And maybe you had the same kind of experience, but it's humbling to realize how hard it really is in day-to-day life to love your neighbor. We can boast that, oh, well, we're in church, and we pass out gallons of love bags to the needy on the streets, and we can boast that we volunteer at schools and feeding programs and agencies to help the underserved, and we can boast that we donate to advocacy programs, but sometimes it's the day-to-day trials that remind us we cannot rest on our laurels. This week we look at the commandments that make us think about the perspective of another person. Respecting parents, lives, unions, and property. That's how we love each other. Martin Luther understood these commandments as directions about how we should live with each other in a sometimes unhappy, difficult world. Clearly, we wouldn't need these to be spelled out if we didn't have people who sometimes disrespected their parents or hurt someone or stole someone or had an affair or lied. But these are temptations in the real world. So like I said, it's easy to say you love someone, but it's really not so easy when what they do makes us angry, when we decide our desires need to be fulfilled, and when we can't agree. Luther described the meaning of the commandment regarding false witness as coming to your neighbor's defense and interpreting, quote, everything they do in the best possible light. I did not really do that at the JFX traffic jam. I did not see that what other people were doing and how they were driving, I did not see that in the best possible light. And what got in the way of my love for them was me. I got in the way. This part of the Ten Commandments is meant to take us out of ourselves and to consider how to improve things for our neighbor. Not self-improvement, but neighbor improvement. If we think not of our own desires, but the needs of others, then we will follow these. We will respect other people's property, their marriages, their reputations. How do we help other people live? How do we protect other people? How do we get out of our self-centered lives and really care about the other? In college, I had a friend who went to all of the Christian student group meetings, but I heard him say several times, I love God, it's people I can't stand. You can't do that. You can't just love God. You can't stop at making God number one and honoring God's name and keeping the Sabbath. It's not about you and God. It's about us, all of us and God. God gave us a community to consider and some very specific rules about how to do that. And just think back to when the Israelites got these commandments. They had been a people who were free from slavery in Egypt. They were free. So now what? Clearly, being free was not the end goal. God didn't free them from Pharaoh's oppression for the sake of their individual freedom. Oh, no. They were freed for a purpose. And that purpose is spelled out in the Decalogue. It is that they needed to love God and love neighbor. Again, Martin Luther wrote about the responsibility to care for each other when he said, "A Christian is the most free lord of all and subject to none. And a Christian is the most dutiful servant of all and subject to everyone." Just last week, we celebrated Juneteenth, and we're about a week away from celebrating the 4th of July. These are celebrations of freedom in our nation. I have the freedom to do this, and it's my right to do that. That kind of talk is nowhere near what God is talking about in this part of the Ten Commandments. The lives of the faithful should not be about doing what we want because it's our right, or exercising our freedom no matter what. We have been freed in Christ for the reason of loving. So when we look at those commands that are listed today, the list of people we need to care deeply about, you're commanded to honor your parents, you're commanded to care about the life of your neighbor, you're commanded to honor your life partner and the romantic relationships of others, you're commanded to protect your neighbor's property and their reputation. There's not one tiny bit in here about doing what you want and the heck with everyone else. But our world is so complicated right now, and sometimes so divided. There's been a rash of homes with pride flags in their yards that have been set on fire. Recent Supreme Court rulings have made us think about who can carry a concealed weapon or how you get that weapon, and whose life is most important in a pregnancy. The presiding bishop of the ELCA, Bishop Elizabeth Eaton, released a statement Friday and reminded the church of the divergent viewpoints about when life begins, but also that there are complicated situations in some pregnancies. Bishop Eaton said in this statement, "We have both the freedom and the obligation to serve neighbors in complex situations. As a church, we are called at this moment to recognize and spiritually support people who are struggling with decisions around pregnancy." This is not an easy time to love our neighbor when we're talking about issues of safety, healthcare, poverty, access, life. The Ten Commandments force us to leave the comfort of our own thoughts and to think about things in another person's point of view. Do we only defend the lives of people that we think are valuable? Do we still respect someone's property when they have a pride flag flying at their home? Do we honor our parents when we disagree with them? Do we take to social media to troll and threaten those who have political opinions we disagree with? Do we try to see what our neighbor is doing in the best possible light in a traffic jam on JFX? Loving our neighbors is more than words. It is not easy, but it is what God commands us to do. It's not the 10 suggestions, it's the 10 commandments. It is our job. It is our vocation to love God and neighbor. Amen. In your bulletin, there are a few questions that you might want to think about as you go through your day. Number one, how do each of these commandments ensure dignity for other people? And number two, does sharing your God-given gifts help other people? I now invite you to rise as you are able as we confess together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now we continue with our prayers of intercession. Again, as you're able, you're welcome to stay in your seat. But if you choose, we sometimes like to make a big circle so that we're making a circle of prayer on the exterior aisles of the church. If you didn't want to bring your bulletin with you, each petition ends with God in your mercy, and your response is hear our prayer.
United in Christ and guided by the Spirit, we pray for the church, the creation, and all in need. God of faithfulness, set the face of your church firmly on you. Rooted in your self-giving love, may the church find freedom in loving our neighbors. God in your mercy.
Amen.
God of gentleness, strengthen the earth's ability to heal. Where there are dangerous storms, bring calm. Where there are destructive fires, bring rain. Protect homes, habitats, and livelihoods threatened by earthquakes, like the one in Afghanistan this week, and climate disasters. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of peace, guide all governed, that they place the good of their citizens above self-promotion. Anoint leaders of nations with your spirit of neighborly love. Protect refugees and all who live under tyranny or conflict. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of kindness, reveal your healing presence to all who are sick or dying, especially among our members, Jack, Carol, Glenn, Helen, Chris, Andrew, Doris, David, Stolfin, Bill, Frankie, and Barbara, and among our friends, Keith, Susan, Bill, Danielle, Jay and his family, Albert of Delbert, Y.E., Jessica, Lawrence, Roger, Mary, Marcia, Frank, Elijah, Sarah, Cisco, Rachel, Ashley, Julia, Alton, Norma, Tina, Ray, Ron, William, Walter, Michelle, John, and Carol. Uphold those who grieve, support the needs of any who are unemployed, hungry, who have nowhere to lay their heads. God, in your mercy.
Yeah.
God of love, attend to those struggling with addiction, depression, or uncontrolled anger. Provide support systems and loving companions as they work towards health, that they may rest in hope. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Be with those responding to this pandemic around the world and those who suffer due to COVID. Watch over those who stand up for equality and justice issues made clearer through this pandemic. Break barriers that prevent political enemies from working together in places like Myanmar, Belarus, Ethiopia, Israel, Palestine, the Church of the Holy Land, Afghanistan, Haiti, and especially Ukraine. Fill us anew with your Holy Spirit, God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Bless Baltimore and our online mission field for our leaders, Joe, Larry, Brandon, and our bishops, Elizabeth and Bill. For those who seek healing through the 12-step programs, usually offered in our coffee house. For our prayer partner at First Lutheran Church in Ewing, Michigan, God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of joy, we give thanks to all who have died and now celebrate the inheritance of life in you. Keep their examples of faithfulness always before us, that we trust your promises in life and in death. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of every time and place, in Jesus' name, and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust these spoken words and prayers and those in our hearts into your holy keeping. Amen.
You may return to your seat.
And again, we are still in a time of pandemic. We don't pass the plate right now. There's information in your bulletin about how you can make a donation online or texting a donation. There's the address if you'd like to mail something. And at the registration table, there is a little box for you to put in your offering. So these are just ways that we can offer something back and to respond to the gifts that God has given us. And now we're very grateful to have Jorge Ramirez Sanchez and Melina Kiefer, who are going to be sharing their gifts and talents, their offering to the Lord right now.
Let us pray. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest, As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all, in the name of Jesus. Amen. I invite you now to rise as we begin with our great Thanksgiving.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Sweet.
All right, well, thank you again to Miranda for that wonderful ballad. And now let us pray together. Life-giving God, through this meal you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. And in your bulletin there's a whole list of different things that are going on. I did want to call to your attention that we are starting to collect food for Getco Cares. It's a food pantry. We weren't able to do our usual collection at Super Bowl. That was not a good COVID time. So we're definitely doing it now. So if you'd like to bring in food, you can put it up here or leave it in the back. And there's a list of items that they need in your bulletin. Also, just a reminder, we have a capital campaign going on. So if you need information, Bruce would be happy to talk to you. And you can turn in your pledge if you haven't yet. We have a few interest polls. We're trying to make sure we know who's interested in a potluck dinner or an Oktoberfest. So there's information about just letting us know if you plan on going to that. There are still a few things that are going on in our community. We have a special worship service. The Pride Interfaith Service is this Thursday at St. Mark's, our sister congregation just down the block. So that'll be at 7:30 for all those who are interested. And there's more information about upcoming things. Next Sunday, July 3rd, is Game Show Sunday. Yes, I get bored in the summer. Yes, we do fun things. So. It's going to be a round of Family Feud and Name That Hymn. So hope you're planning to come and have a little bit of fun for that. The following Sunday is all about listening. Please rise now as you are able for the blessing of travelers. Today we seek God's blessing upon those among us who will travel this summer. Let us pray together. Lord God, our Father, you kept Abraham and Sarah in safety throughout the days of their pilgrimage. You led the children of Israel through the midst of the sea, and by a star you led them out to the infant Jesus. Protect and guide those who set out to travel. Make their way safe and their homecomings joyful. And bring us at last to our heavenly home, where you dwell in glory with your Son and the Holy Spirit, God forever. Amen. Before the final blessing, I did want to say special welcome to some of the guests we have. Jorge has his father with us today from Puerto Rico. Also, George and Nancy Mulholland are here. They're family friends. You just wave. They're family friends from when I'm a teenager. No, they have no stories about me. And Edison is my father, Alan. I'm so glad to have you worship with us. Welcome. And now our blessing, the God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you and comfort you and show you the path of life this day and always. Amen. Amen. Our sending song is Father, We Thank You, which is found on the next page.
Oh,
Go in peace. Love your neighbor.
Thanks be to God.
Happy Father's Day!